for liturgists, Exodus 1. One is for those who will provide coffee hour retreats. Now, again, I point out two people here in the choir, Stu and Mary, will tell you about what is required to do coffee hour, and they will help you, especially for those people who love their coffee. They'll tell you exactly how many scoops you put in. I'm not a coffee drinker, so I go to them, I say, how many do you want? Because I know people are particular about their coffee in the morning. But this one is for a liturgist, and we have covered up until October 8th. So if you would like to be the liturgist, please sign this up.
Thank you. It's like reconciling the family so that all lines of communication and love can be clear. Thank you, God, for your confession. God has promised that whenever we repent and seek a new union with God, forgiveness is ours. That promise comes true now. Sisters and brothers, know that in Christ, you sit right there. Do you hear that? That's where I want us to definition of commission, I like this definition of yours, try this on. A commission is a command to act in a certain manner or to perform prescribed acts. I like that one, the word commission. It's really two words. Co-mission. Mission is about serving another, right? Putting yourself out there for somebody else. But that prefix, that first syllable, co, always means alongside, with, a bridge to somebody or something else. So what we're really talking about when we talk about commission is the great come alongside somebody to serve them, but better than with somebody. It's part of the reason Jesus tried to instruct people to go out two by two. Just like for kids, something powerful happens when we're joining in selfless effort with someone else to do something for someone less fortunate. I think it's key to being a church. This is not an individualistic activity. It's a group sport together. Now, I got to tell you, no surprise to you probably, loads of preachers and evangelists have used this very passage of Jesus's when he said, over the years to fire up the troops, to go tell others how to follow Christ, in hopes of convincing that person to want to follow Christ too. And that can be a great thing. I think I don't know about you, but in my own faith formation as a teenager, it was hearing another teen friend talk about how some spiritual stirrings were happening in them. That got me curious that life could be more than what I was living in. Also hear in Christ's words today that it's not just about the words. Rather, it's about showing the world what you believe by what you do, by how you spend your time, your money, how you pour yourself into people. I really like the writer, Brian McLaren, who talks about distinguishing between right beliefs, right practices. Just to throw his language to you. Orthodoxy, maybe you've heard that word. Orthodox means to be in right or common belief. Yeah. And United Methodists and Congregationalists, we happen to not require everyone to be exactly the same thing. Frankly, I like that about our conditions. It's not so important that we believe all the same things. We believe Christ is at the center. But McLaren, and I think many in our two traditions would say, maybe orthodoxy is not important as orthopraxy. And orthopraxy, praxy means practices, means to have right practice or faithful practices. Another way to say this, friends, is in the church, we are at our best when we're joining efforts, rolling up our sleeves together, caring for the poor, even when we are not all on the exact same page of understanding belief and doctrine. I just think that's so important. We don't have to be on the same page always. And this is something very alive for me as a Christian that comes out of the tradition of Methodism. If you don't know, our denomination is in the throes of a great splintering, if you will, around understanding and inclusivity. And we're a small here, really glad and proud of inclusivity of all people in the church and practical leadership in the church. And I moved to this town where the church that's out of my tradition has recently broken away from the denomination to have a more orthodoxy, more conservative position. And while that saddens me at some level, I will gladly roll up my sleeves and do something in mission with that congregation. I think that's the stretch my group is reading to do. Preach the gospel always, and when necessary, use words. You've heard that before. It's attributed to St. Francis of Assisi, that reformed preacher. Preach the gospel always, if necessary, use words. I think he gets the great commission. It's about convincing. It's about modeling. gospel by their acts, and the world began to take notice, wanted to be part of such a loving, revolutionary movement. Why, I dare say, it's really why you and I are sitting in this room together today, because of that attitude of wanting to share that was in our forebears. Now, at the same time, you know, we're reading about the church growing, and we're all on a mission to live our faith out there. Wouldn't you agree that we live in a day when fewer people are part of church life in this country? We live in a time when we're more likely than ever to have someone of another faith be our neighbor or our colleague or our workmate. We're also more likely to have a neighbor who claims no faith at all. But nothing has changed in those marching orders of Matthew 26, where Jesus says, go and live out your faith in front of other people. Go, therefore, making disciples by living your faith. So for just a moment, I'd like you to meet a writer who's on my follow named Brian. Brian McClaren mentioned just a few minutes ago, I suppose. Brian was once a pastor of a little church in Maryland, and he was pastoring there on that terrible day in September of 2001 when planes ran into buildings, the sad anniversary of which us have lit candles and thought about this week. But he would say that he started living the Great Commission in front of his neighbors on that day in a way he hadn't really paid attention to until then. Like a lot of churches, Brian's in the congregation. I wonder how you all did it up here in a congregational church. But his church held a prayer service all that week, gathered with other congregations, following the terrorist attacks. Saw how awkward this appeared, so I ran his brakes and got out and
established a friendship.
And he gave the imam a letter that he brought, sealed with an envelope. He said, "Would you just read this now? It tells you why I'm here."
He stood there awkwardly. He remembers the imam, a man short in stature, slowly looking down at the letter in a bright September sun, then up into Ryan's face, back down, then up, and then back down to read a couple of more lines. Each time he looked up, his eyes were moist. Suddenly, the Muslim imam threw his arms around this Christian pastor, a perfect stranger who had entered his property in a less than normal way. "Oh, it means so much to me that you would come," the imam said. "Please, please, please come inside." So that day began a friendship between an evangelical pastor and a Muslim imam who we will call the Mawlana. What followed were community meals, shared with one another's houses of worship, panel discussions, and women of the church, thank you women, who offered to walk any Muslim woman to her appointments if she feared reprisals and hostile neighbors. That, my friends, is what our light shines. Bearing the light without having to convince it or convert it. That, I think, is living the Great Commission spoken by Jesus as his last words. Now, did this encounter I just told you about, did it result in any Muslims deciding to convert to Christianity? Probably not. But that wouldn't have been the point. I can tell you, though, that a doubting world watches. A doubting world is watching to see if we Christians are real. If we just associate and socialize among ourselves, or if we're actually going places and doing things that bless others, crossing lines to do so. In my denomination, there is a global gathering that happens every few years. I remember going to Portland, Oregon a few years ago for our United Methodist General Conference, and one of our bishops, Sally Dick, from the Midwest, Sally Dick spoke to this great community gathering we all seen in Portland, and she recounted how she used to be a superintendent, you know, overseeing other churches in Ohio, and she lived in a town that had a little daily paper. It was one of those papers, even smaller than the magazine paper, that you could read through in 3 or 4 minutes pretty quickly. So one night she came home and she just went through the little community paper. There was this article on the front page about an event happening in one of the churches in her community. The article was about the First Church of God. But they lifted the printers in the newspaper had left off the D in the word God. So the headline was, "The First Church of Go." Let that sink in a minute. That's not such a bad misspelling. I want to be part of the First Church of Go. Go, therefore, says Jesus. Imagine what might happen around the world if more and more Christians rediscover that central to Christian life is what we can call subversive friendship. When we cross the lines of a friend, just to be faithful and not even so much to convince or change someone's mind. In this age of great polarization, politically, spiritually, and so forth, I think we're onto something in these words. Your point's not to convince, but it's just to be authentic in our faith in front of another person. Imagine what could happen if our experience of communion around the Lord's table, when we receive it, if we let it actually motivate us, like the Lord himself to enjoy table fellowship, Muslims and Hindus, Christians and Buddhists, most subtle difference in movement, but I think it's very important. I think for the church to thrive going forward in a post-Christian culture, we've got to be very good, or learn to be very good, at asking people to join us in acts of mission to care for someone who's struggling, whether they are on the same page of belief or no age at all.
I'd love to chat with any of you about that.
Anyway, if we cross lines more generally and unselfconsciously live faith in front of other people, whatever they're going to think, I believe what would happen is that a world would notice and lean in and engage with us and the people of the world. And maybe it's maybe curious about this Jesus. Hey, a tune from a great musical that came out this afternoon, Godspell. It's called Day by Day. It's in our hymnals and remain seated. We're just going to sing it through a couple of times. You'll find it on page 342. See, this is our own way of asking God to let the words do this to us. 342, we'll sing it through twice. Thank you. cannot speak, peace, when all hope seems to disappear.
We pray for our friend and to those who seek.
In the midst of rage, violence, and disappointment, and in the midst of wars and destruction of the earth, Lord, show us your light.
good to see you up, but I don't have much of a voice. I have laryngitis. It's my allergy. So are you doing better?
Up to a point.
It's good to see you out.
Last week I had a phone call for you.